Good morning, students. So in our last class, we have discussed brucellosis. We have discussed the pathogen, the type of pathogen a brucella is, and in which host they basically thrive, and how they can cause various types of manifestations in various types of host. So that was our main aim, and there also I highlighted that this disease is basically a zoonotic disease, a disease which basically is mainly seen in animals, but human becomes a host by chance. So that was a zoonotic disease, and you know that there are many zoonotic diseases which has a huge and grave importance to the society till late. So this is one of them. And today we will start with a very depth and insight of brucellosis. And the first and foremost thing is that I will discuss the various species of brucella and where this particular organism thrives. These are the points which I will discuss today. So Brucella melitensis, the principal host is goat and sheep, and it is most pathogenic in humans. This point is need to be noted, you know, that there are many diseases which do not have a severe manifestation in animal, may by chance be transmitted to human being and can have a severe manifestation. Because you know that the animals know how to confer immunity against this pathogen, but if this pathogen becomes, if human becomes a host by chance and it is very new, then it is very difficult for the immune system to recognize, and those diseases usually becomes more transmissible and more severe for mankind. So sporadic case in human in the US occur related to consumption of unpasteurized dairy product from countries where the disease is present. So unpasteurized, you know that there are many other diseases like, you know, bovine tuberculosis, another disease in which it is being transmitted if you drink milk which is unpasteurized. So unpasteurized products should not be taken and it should be avoided. Next, as the name suggests, Brucella abortus, and the principal host is basically cattle. Now, when I'm talking of abortus, abortion comes from the word abortion. So they basically grow in the placenta of the cattle, and usually that leads to abortion. Eradication of Brucella abortus from cattle is nearly complete in the US, but the disease still occurs in some wild bisons, etc. So Brucella abortus is another organism. Next is your Brucella suis. Principal host is swine, found in pigs, wild hog. Hunters are at the risk of becoming infected when they field dress infect pigs. So you know that when the hunters are basically affected, because when they are after these organisms, these animals, they usually get the disease. Now, you know, here I will give you an interesting story. I will tell you an interesting story. So do you know, I will just talk about one organism, HIV, human immunodeficiency virus. And you know that it is a causative agent of AIDS, and once it was a pandemic. Now, you know, this HIV has been a zoonotic disease. It has been isolated, or it has been there in the rhesus monkey. So it is, this organism has basically been transmitted to some hunters in the rainforest while hunting and poaching. Their blood, this infected blood, had come in contact with those hunters, and that had resulted in the transmission into the human. And you know that how devastating it was, though it is a chronic disease now, but it was, and you know, the transmission was through the body fluid, and absolutely there is no vaccines, no prevention strategies for HIV. So next is your Brucella canis. So Brucella canis, the principal host is dog. Individuals who are in close contact with dog breeders, veterinary staff who assist with birth are at a risk of becoming infected. CDC does not currently perform serological testing for Brucella canis. So we can actually talk of Brucella canis. So Brucella canis is another one. So next, move on to the epidemiology. Now you know that you need to, as a student of BMLT, you need to understand epidemiology very nicely. You know that now we are in a present situation where there is an exponential transmission of novel coronavirus 2019 causing the disease COVID-19. And you know that people are trying to learn their epidemiology and how, by learning through the epidemiology, this particular disease transmission, the chain can be broken and the whole world, the eternity, can be saved from this deadly pathogen. So epidemiology, so Brucella occurs worldwide. Major endemic areas include Mediterranean Basin, Arabian Gulf, Indian subcontinent, and Mexico, Central and South America. Human infection, melitensis, is a species that infects humans most frequently. And the incubation period ranges from few days to few months. So you understand that it is few days to few months. So you know that incubation period is very important. I will again focus on this because again I will try to correlate with the present situation. You know that the incubation period for coronavirus is 14 days. And in this long 14 days, one is unable to understand whether he or she is infected. So that is the time when this active infection could be transmitted, active pathogen can be transmitted to healthier individuals. So here the incubation period is few days to few months. So you understand that during that period of time, the organism can be transmitted to many healthy animals in the population if it is not controlled or identified. The disease is manifested as fever accompanied by a wide array of other symptoms. So fever is the main basic symptom. Then comes the mode of transmission. That is also very important, because if we don't know the mode of transmission, we don't know how to stop it. So the mode of transmission here is direct inoculation through cut and skin abrasion from handling animal carcasses. So you are handling animal carcasses, placentas, or contact with some vaginal secretion of animal, your cut skin, your abraded skin, your wounded skin, then you may have the transmission. Direct conjunctival inoculation, inhalation of infectious aerosol. Ingestion of contaminated food such as raw milk, cheese made from unpasteurized raw milk or raw meat. Veneral transmission has been suggested, but the data are not conclusive. But so you understand that it can be transmitted by various ways, like from the cut skin, from directly from the conjunctiva. Inhalation, that is, it's also having a part in the like the infected aerosol, and also by the oral route. That means if you can even drink that particular contaminated food, then you may have the disease. Incubation period, that is very important. Acute or subacute disease follows an incubation period which can vary 1 week to 6 or more months. So it may remain there in your body for months and you don't know that it is having in your body. In most patients for whom the time of exposure can be identified, the incubation period is between 2 to 6 weeks. The length of the incubation period may be influenced by many factors, like virulence of the infecting strain. If it is less virulent, you will not be able to understand that it is having proposing some negative effect in your system. Size of the inoculum, lower the lethal dose, takes time to establish the infection. Higher the lethal dose, lesser time is required to establish the infection, route of infection, and of course the resistant mechanism of the host which will resist the overall disease. Next we will move on to the clinical manifestations. The most important manifestation is knee fever, night sweat, malaise, anorexia, arthralgia, fatigue, weight loss. Because you know that this organism remains in your body even for 6 months. So it will have some effect, some negative effect in you, and that can be weight loss and depression. So let's start into the very details of it. The presentation of brucellosis is characteristically variable. So it is variable. The onset may be indigenous or abrupt. Abruptly there is a particular clinical manifestation. Influenza like fever, limbs and back pain, sweating and fatigue, anorexia, weakness, severe fatigue, loss of weight, headache. The leukocyte counts tend to be normal or reduced with a relative lymphocytosis, relative leukopenia. So leukocytes may reduce. On physical examination, you may have an enlarged spleen. Splenomegaly may be the only finding. Often fits into the three pattern: febrile illness resembling typhoid, less severe, fever and acute monoarthritis, hip, knee, joints are swelled, young in child, long lasting fever, hip pain, older man travels to an endemic area, there may be some features, occupation, consumption of unpasteurized milk, these are the high risk group which may have the disease. Physical examination may be absent, manifestation may be absent. It present musculoskeletal pain, osteomyelitis, septic arthritis, minimal lymphadenopathy, there is a swelling of lymph node, hepatosplenomegaly, there is a swelling of your liver and your spleen may occur. Now, there are systemic infections in brucellosis as well through blood. So, osteoarticular disease, 20-30%, and vertebral spondylitis, large joints are affected more commonly in children. So, through the blood they may reach the bone and they can cause a severe type of inflammation. Genitourinary disease, especially epididymorchitis, so it goes to epididymis, 2-40% of the males. Neurobrucellosis, usually present as meningitis in the neurons, 1-2 in the meninges in 1-2%. Less common neurological complication includes optic neuropathy, radiculopathy, stroke, intracerebral hemorrhages. So you understand that though this particular disease is in the cattle, but if it is transmitted into the human, so there is a vast majority of symptoms, majority of the disease it can cause. And it's just you have to prevent yourself from coming in contact with the cattle. And if you even come in contact, be safe, take the precautions. And also, don't drink unpasteurized milk and milk products. Patients with undiagnosed and untreated brucellosis can be symptomatic for months. And in addition, previously treated patient may be present with relapsed infection. So there may be relapsed infections. Chronic brucellosis, the presence of granulomatous hepatitis, hepatic microabscess, bone marrow granulomas, hemophagocytosis should prompt further diagnostic evaluation. So you know that I told you, here I tell you one thing, that is when I talk of acute and your chronic disease, you know, acute means the symptoms will come in exponential way and it will subside. Subside means when there is no equilibrium between the host and the pathogen, either the host has to survive or the pathogen. So if pathogen survives, the host dies. If the host survives, the pathogen dies. So the symptoms will subside. But if the symptoms doesn't occur and you have the organism in a very low level in your system and you don't know, the equilibrium has been established between the host and the pathogen, the most important thing which comes into mind is that it will be devastating, because it will take time to create that devastation, but you are unaware of the fact that they are multiplying, they are growing in you. They are, you know, one of the very important example I have already discussed in your class, the story of Mary Mellon, who is also called as Typhoid Mary. She is the one who is responsible for typhoid epidemic twice, and because she was just a silent carrier of your Salmonella typhi. So this is very, very important. So chronic has to be identified and eliminated. Relapse. About 10% of the patient relapse after therapy. So it, you know, here another thing comes into play that I will again try to discuss with you, that even if you take antibiotics and all those preventive medications, only 90% of the pathogen is removed and 10% of the pathogen remains, and that is removed by your vascular immune system. So if you are immunocompromised, if you don't have vascular immune system, of course this particular disease will reoccur again and again, because you know that your immune system is not being able to remove or eliminate the pathogen from your system, and again when your immunity subsides, again it multiplies and relapses. So about 10% of the patient relapse after the therapy, and most relapse occur within 3 months following therapy, and almost all occur within 6 months. So risk factor for relapse include inadequate initial therapy, you have not taken the medication, duration of the initial illness of less than 10 days, male sex, bacteremia, and of course thrombocytopenia. So there are various reasons of relapse, and one of the reasons which I have already told is not a vascular immune system. That is very important. Like I told you that in a HIV patient, why pneumonia occurs again and again? Why there is relapsing pneumonia again and again? I gave you an example of the patient who was in Apollo Gleneagles in Kolkata, and the person has undergone a bypass surgery, and after that there was recurrent infection, pneumonia again and again, again and again, resulting in a loss of weight from 75 kgs to 46 kgs when he again came back to the hospital 1 year later, and it was found out that he was suffering from stage 4 HIV. So why pneumonia? Because the immune system is not versed in clearing off the pathogen, and the pathogen is coming back again and again causing the disease. So that is the reason of recurrent disease which occurs again and again. So thanks students. So with this I will end my class today. So next day we will start with the diagnosis strategy, prevention strategy, and also the treatment strategy by which we can eliminate out this pathogen. Thank you. If you have any question, any query, please feel free to write in the comment box against my video in the Google Classroom. So I will be free. Please be non-hesitant to interact with me, and I will give you the answers. And if possible, I will give you those tutorial videos which will help you out in understanding those parts which you have not understood. Thank you once again.